let's start talking a little bit about Angola and how is it relating to birding in the Southern Africa region, what Angola has to offer, and lots of other small details. We'll talk also, we'll touch issues of a little bit of culture, a little bit of fun, and we'll try to make it lively as possible, even though the webinar is kind of a dry, we'll try to make it lively. Let's go. So first, let's kind of get to know where is Angola. So Angola, as you see, it's right in the southern western part of Africa. It's a huge country. It's 1.2 million square kilometers. And it's seldom visited country in Africa. So why we should go there? Well, it's like ringing the jackpot in the birdwatching world. It has 15 endemic species, some say quite a few more, depends on the taxonomy. Plenty of range restricted species, especially shared with the DRC, a country that is usually considered a dangerous place for birders to visit. And also it's part of the Southern Africa greater region. So who am I? Derek asked for a presentation, a quick presentation. I'm from Israel. I mostly declare myself as a conservationist, but I also consider that conservation cannot work without making money out of it. So I promote entrepreneurship relates to combination, how to combine the community development with conservation. And of course, I'm a hardcore bird watcher. I have been seeing over 7,500 species visiting all the continents. And I co-authored the first field guide to the birds of Peru together with Mr. Clements. Many of you know of him from the Clements list, those that eBird, so they know the Clements list. Let's give a little bit of taste of Africa, of Angola, by listening to a little bit of music. So, and usually when you come to Angola, you've been, you are greeted with, to the villages, you are greeted with lots of music and dance, very colorful, and let's get a taste of it too. And this is in the southern part of Angola.
We can't hear what you're saying, Noam, because the music's too loud.
Okay, I said this was in southern Angola, a typical dance of the Mumila tribe. Northern Angola is more related to the culture, to the Congo. So it's a different type of dance and especially different types of musical instruments. And Angola is a land of great diversity. You see, it has a very long coastline, and about 70 kilometers from the coast, we have a rise of the escarpment. This escarpment is almost like a factory for endemic species. All the endemic species of Angola along this escarpment. In the southeastern part of the country, it's what we call the Tower of Waters, as a where the Okavango Basin and five major rivers starts over there. And it has a range of extreme desert to tropical rainforest, really very large range of habitats. We started in this country, in Angola, a project called Betting, Developing Bird Tourism, Apostar no Avitourismo, to develop a birding route, prepare local guides, train with the private sector, and to conserve key sites, of course, to promote the country. It's part of what we do right now. So let's go to the Angola birding route and see what it offers to the bird watchers. First, it offers all the endemic species and most of the specialties. 4 critically endangered species and 17 endangered species. About 500 species in a typical 2.5 week trip. I just did a trip like this and we saw over 500 species, many restricted range species. In many of the key sites, we already trained local guides and visit a great diversity of habitats.
Sorry, no, we can't hear you. The music's too loud.
Sorry about it. It's technical issues we have to resolve. So we will start from the south because we can either do it clockwise or counterclockwise. And if we start from the south, we can fly from the capital, Luanda, to the city of Lubango in the province of Huila in the south part of the country. And the first site that we will visit is Tundavala, a beautiful part of the escarpment. We'll see a short video about it in a second. And this will be our first birding site on the route. And this is a short video we made about Tundavala and its birds, and really stunning. So Tundavala is an escarpment. It has a drop of about 1,200 meters, a very sheer drop. But it's not only stunningly beautiful, it's also very rich in birds and other wildlife. But the birds here, some of them shared with northern Namibia, but one, for example, this white-bellied barbet, has been a long disappeared, then was refound. This is the Angola waxbill, is endemic bird of Angola. Recently, the Angola cave chat been found in northern Namibia, just across the border. And the rock runner, of course, it's more common in Namibia. This is the montane double collar sunbird, now most recognized as the full species Ludwig double collared sunbird, and we'll have a look at a few other birds that we see in the area. Those are common birds. And in this, in Tundavala, you will find local guides that are well trained to show you around through this beautiful scenery. So this is the Angola cave chat. Is not only a near endemic species, also it's a unique and endemic genus. The Bocages accolat can be found in the small Bocages, like South African pronounce, found in the creeks with a little bit more vegetation. And the local guides are usually keep track on where the whereabouts of this white-bellied barbet in that has only very, very few territories, a very rare bird. We continue our journey toward the desert in the Namib Desert. And where that's where we find the Mumila and the Mukubal tribes, nomad tribes that live in the area, in the very dry desert. And to get there, we have to go this through beautiful road, a snake-like road that drops from the escarpment into the desert. And in the desert, you find one of the strangest plants on planet Earth, the Wilwitschia mirabilis, which is grows, this particular specimen is probably over 2,000-3,000 years old. And we found birds of the desert. So for example, the Kalahari scrub robin, the mountain wheat ear, Acacia pied barbet, Montero's hornbill, and a few others that are shared with the next site, which is Talamajamba. So Talamajamba is already in close to Benguela, a very pleasant town. In Talamajamba, we can find also desert a habitat of few types.
Beneath the impressive slopes of Serra de Leba is the village of Mangaeras.
Not this one. And we find very common the Benguela longbill lark, exceptionally common in this area. Hartalobe, Francolin, which usually duetting in the early morning. If you know how to detect them, they're very common in the area. And we'll continue north to Morro de Moco. Morro de Moco is the tallest mountain in Angola and above 2,600 meters, and is home to many, many interesting species. So what's interesting, it starts with the grassland. You can see here the small village of Kanjonde and then in the creeks that are forested, that's where most of the birding is done. So we have, before we get there, we have the montane grassland, many interesting species like Angola lark, black and rufous swallow, Bocage's weaver, Bocage's sunbird. And as we continue up, we can find in the forest gorgeous bushrike that actually is a common bird in many habitats in Angola. And you will hear it, of course, much more often than you'll see it. Western green tinker bird, also very common in the area. In certain Miombe forest there, you'll find the black-neck ermomela. In many habitats in the area, you will see the shallows turaco, a very beautiful, well-marked, beautiful eyelashes. And also the brown-faced barbet. Well, this is a typical argument between the couple. You can guess who is the male and who is the female here. That doesn't take too much sophistication. And like in every couple, it ends in what else we can do. So let's move on to the Kumbira forest, further up north. Unfortunately, the area is quite degraded, but yet you can find cool stuff in this forested in mixed with river. We'll move on. The Gabela Akalat is endemic, lives in the understory, not very impressive by look, but when you look at the distribution map, it becomes a far more interesting bird. It has a tiny limited distribution. The critically endangered Gabela bushrike, this bird in 1990 was considered fairly common, and now it's pretty much became critically endangered. It didn't take much deforestation, and this bird is on its way out. It has very small, very few pairs left. Gorgeous yellow belly, the water lily, just like stuffed animal, a toy animal, still fairly common in the area, and real joyful to look. And yellow-bellied barbet is, again, you hear it a lot, a little bit more harder to detect where it's coming from. And ragneck buzzard is flying in many places overhead in Angola. This particular photo was taken in Kumbira. And of course, the Angola national bird, the red-crested turaco. Turacos, as many know, is a family endemic to Angola. This particular one is looks similar to the one in a Cameroon border with Nigeria, the Bannerman turaco. This one is commonly heard in about from Kumbira up north, and it's very beautiful, and very happy to see it every time that you encounter it. And many will recognize the sound of this beautiful bird. As we continue north, we are leaving already all the dry areas that we had in the south. We are now getting more and more into tropical habitat. So we are now in Kinjila, which is already fairly up north in the country, in the province of Malanje. Kinjila is also right next to the impressive waterfalls of Kalandula. That is also the photo in my background. And not very far from there is the small village that holds a very nice miombe forest that includes the host, the Anchieta barbet, the rufous belly teat, lots of dusky twin spot that are fairly common in the edges. But the big star of the area is the white-headed robinchet, which has tiny little distribution only in Angola and in the DRC. So Kinjila is a sure bet to see this bird. The local guides there can take you directly into territories of the white-headed robinchet. And this is a fantastic bird, absolutely fantastic. We were in Kinjila not long ago, and without trying to see many species in one day, we reached over 110 species, and many of them are fantastic. Things like Brussels martin, like the white-headed robinchet, like the barbet that I showed earlier, a gray-winged robinchet, the cliff swallow, red-throated cliff swallow, and many, many other birds. It was just a fantastic day. So here's a close-up of this robinchet. And this is the small village of Kinjila, a very simple place, but a great place to visit. People are very nice, very friendly, and the place is super clean. This is the beginning of a training course of how to start becoming a bird watching guide. And the guys there really know their stuff. Had been graduated with the president of the former minister of tourism. And you know, the Congolese forest is very extended, very extensive. In the Mangola, in the province of Fish, we have a great example of the forest. It's not, it's remains of a forest, really small patches that remain, but they're still very productive, and you still get fantastic birds like in the edge of the forest, black-collar bulbul. In it's very rare elsewhere. We had one day with over 40 individuals. A banded prinia, again, a typical central Western Africa bird, lowland mascapalis. And this is a very interesting thing, the white-collared oliveback, which is a small disjunct population away from Uganda, where I saw it previous to that. And we saw them nesting there, and they maybe one day they will be considered as separate species, I don't know. But it is a very interesting range extension into Angola. But the real star of the place is the brown bushrike, endemic, exceptionally localized bird, and surprisingly enough, very easy to detect. Actually, it took us less than 2 minutes to find the bird. As we left the car, immediately we could hear it and see it consequently. We are ending the tour. We are already getting into returning toward the capital, toward Luanda, in a small village called Santa Mbulea. And this is a savanna, tropical savanna forest with lots of baobab deciduous. And the first look doesn't look very impressive. However, very quickly you discover that this place is loaded with interesting birds. So this is how it looks in when it has leaves. And immediately you hear the Hartred's Camaroptera, an endemic Camaroptera. And a little bit harder to find, but it's still there in fairly good presence. Monteros bushrike, which actually consider, even though it's not considered right now as endemic, but it looks like the information from Cameroon, the specimen from Cameroon was considered shared with between Angola and Cameroon, it looks like it was mislabeled. And for all we know, it is actually present only in Angola. So it should be considered as endemic. A beautiful massive bill. Hearing the sound, once you know the sound, it's fairly easy to detect it. And again, the star of the bird is the Gabella helmet shrike. Again, beautiful eyelashes, nice makeup, an exceptionally limited population. Much of the habitat being converted already to agriculture, but it remains in the area of Santa Mbulea. The local guides will be happy to show you around and find you this specialty. And actually those local guides found a bird that is highly desired by many African birders, the African pitta, sorry of the poor quality of the photo. But during the month of November, December, even the second part of October, this bird is vocal and can be seen with great pleasure in Santa Mbulea. We arrive in the capital, the modern capital of Luanda. And this is the famous Marginal, the waterfront of Luanda. And in this massive urban jungle, we also have some interesting bird, including the endemic red-backed mouse bird that many of the African birders, that's probably the one mouse bird they need to clean up the mouse birds, the family, and African family, of course. And very common in the town, sometimes you see it in the house gardens, the rufous-tailed palm thrush. So, yeah, Angola, yes, had a fame of a dangerous country. Angola has a fame of the civil war that was long fought battle. But let me assure you, right now, Angola is open, is very friendly, it's very safe, away from the large cities, like any large city in the world. The official language in Angola is Portuguese, but in most places, everybody speaks Portuguese. But in the remote villages, people speak the local languages as well, mostly Umbundu, Kimbundu, Nyaneka, and few other languages. The local currency is a Kwanza, Angolan Kwanza. It's usually about traded right now about 600 kwanza to the dollar. Tourism industry is really infant in Angola. Many things that you take for granted in any countries are still just getting started in Angola and improving fast. So patience is a very important asset to equip yourself to. Be patient, make a recommendation to the people how to improve. They're eager to learn. And I think that it will be a win-win situation. Use the local guides wherever it's available. It's another, they will learn from you. You will learn from them. They will pass it on to the community. It will help conservation and it will help to improve everybody, and you will find many more of your targets. Angola is, like many other traditional African countries, is connected with village elders, the soba, as they call them. They are the chief of the village and are highly respected. And it's a good idea to present yourself before you're coming in, tell them that you want to do bird watching. Usually they will say no problem, and they will, and you will be on their side. Let people know that you come to watch bird. Observando passarinhos, as they say in Portuguese. Again, it's will help them to know that you are, that their place is appreciated, and will support conservation as well. So, like in North America, they have the ABA list. The in Europe, many birders follow the Western Palearctic list. In Australia, the Australian region. In South Africa, many people try to compile as big a list of the Southern Africa as they can. And usually they consider Southern Africa as the Namibia, South Africa with Lesotho and the Swatini, Botswana, Zimbabwe, and the southern part of Mozambique. However, we suggest expanding this area, which can make it a very interesting challenge to add more birding to the Southern Africa region, make Southern Africa greater, South Africa great again. And it will add a few hundred species to the region. It will include Angola, Zambia, Malawi, and the full of Mozambique. It's a new challenge, of course. It's as an ICSI, the access to this area is easy despite COVID. Right now, traveling internationally is very complicated and has lots of potential for new discoveries. So, as I said, in Angola, estamos juntos, we are all together in this. And please follow us in any of the channels, birdingangola.com, Birding Angola on Facebook, Birding Angola on Instagram, on YouTube. And surprisingly enough, Angola, that also had the fame of being a very expensive country, is now affordable and very peaceful. So thank you all, and I will be happily to take some questions.
Ah, thank you so much, Noam. And folks, if you have any questions, please just type them in the chat and we'll pick them up there. Unfortunately, there's, I think, a little bit too many people in the room to just open the mics, but if you feel like it, I've unblocked, I've allowed people to unmute themselves. So if you have a question and you would like to do that, go ahead.
Right away, I see an updated a question about a field guide. And right now, there is no field guide available, specifically to Angola. What is happening? We are working on setting up an app that hopefully we'll be able to distribute it for free for the birds of Angola. And I, as far as I know, there is another field guide cooking for the birds of Angola. For those that they cannot wait, for those two specifically country, we use the Ian Sinclair book, All the Birds of Africa South of the Sahara.
Someone's asking how they approach a trip to Angola. Can you self-drive from the south?
Yes, you can. One amazing thing for you guys to know that Angola fuel is exceptionally cheap. You can probably fill up a tank for about 12 US for we drove an Hilux. So for an Hilux or Land Cruiser probably will be about $12.
Wow.
So that's very cheap. Accommodation can be tricky, especially now with COVID that many places we closed down. Camping is easy. No campgrounds right now, but you just come to a village and you camp. You ask the village elders if for permission, and usually they will charge you something like a few dollars to for the permission, which will be deposited in the coffers, the shared coffers of the community. The standard camping stuff, you know, crackers, tuna fish and stuff like this is good, always good to have with you, because sometimes in the villages you cannot find too much supplies.
Susan is asking if there will be a recording available. Yes, it will be on our YouTube channel. It can take up to a week because I have to do the editing. So you have to bear with me. I'm packing my house to move at the moment as well, so it may take a little bit longer than usual. What are the roads like? Is it purely 4x4?
No, actually the roads are, from exceptionally excellent roads to quite a few terrible roads, but those terrible roads are, are usually not must. The only road that is a must is the road coming from going up to Mort Moko, which is fairly bad. They require high clearance vehicle. And another two roads is one that comes from Wij into Kalandula. You can drive around it and it will add another hour to drive, not so bad. And that's about it. The rest of the roads, most of them are very good. There is a piece between, a few bad pieces, but most of the roads are good.
And Leo's asking, what would be the mileage of the tour you took us on today and how long would it take?
That will be about, let's see, 1600. It probably will be about 5,000-6,000 kilometers. I have to check.
5,000-6,000, that's a lot of kilometers.
Yeah, Angola is a big country.
Wow. I mean, from Johannesburg to Cape Town is 1,500. So that's like...
Yeah, but you have a country that you go zigzagging quite a bit.
Okay.
So yeah, it's longer than Johannesburg to Cape Town.
So Allison is asking, glad to hear it's safe. I imagine pockets of local militias still be around.
No, militias are not. The only problem in Angola right now is a really, I would say it's only in Luanda, like any other major metropolis. But actually the birding in Luanda is very limited and the time that you spend in the field is great. We did not experience, in the few trips that I did throughout Angola, I did not experience a single case of violence or unsafety notion. Yeah, so it was very safe.
So I think we can end on that great note with the last comment saying a very interesting presentation. Thank you. And I would echo that and say thank you very much, Noam.
You're all welcome. And please join us in Angola. It will be delighted. Wonderful. Thank you very much.
And it's my intention to do exactly that. Come to Angola sometime soon. I just need to get settled away first.
All right. Wonderful. And looking right. forward for the... looking forward for seeing the video on YouTube.
I'll let you know as soon as I have it up. It takes a little while to edit it, but I'll definitely get it up within the next week or so, hopefully sooner.
Perfect. Great. Talk to you soon. See you guys, everybody.
Thanks again. Bye, everybody. Bye. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning.
All right, great.
Wherever you are. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.